I initially posted this piece in 2020 as a series of Instagram stories, which people found surprisingly entertaining given the nerdiness of the subject matter. I think maybe my total lack of expertise made it more fun and easier to understand. So before we begin, a disclaimer. This exercise is for fun and brain stretching only. Don't take it as hard science, and please forgive any technical inaccuracies. Dimensions. When we talk about a dimension, what we are really talking about is a degree of freedom, or an axis. Given this rule, we can say that a point has no dimensions. It exists at one fixed space-time coordinate and has no variable or degree of freedom. In the same way, the first dimension can be represented as a line. A line has one degree of freedom. The second dimension can be represented by a plane. It has two axes, X and Y. Any position on a plane can be defined with two measurements, an X coordinate and a Y coordinate. The third dimension, you know this one, can be defined by a cube. A cube has 3 degrees of freedom, X, Y, and Z. It has volume and is basically space as we experience it. Typically, we talk about the fourth dimension as time, or at least we assume that we experience time as a fourth dimension. If we think about space as being three-dimensional but existing through the dimension of time, then we can identify any point in space-time with 4 axes, X, Y, Z, and T. Let's look at a few ways to visualize time. Easy 4D visualizations explained. Imagine a 2D being trying to experience the third dimension. The only way a 2D being could experience a 3D cube would be to pass through it one 2D slice at a time. However, we as 3D beings can experience the whole cube at once. So if we use time to represent the fourth dimension, we can say that we as 3D beings can only experience time one 3D slice at a time. A 4D being, however, would experience all time simultaneously, just as we can experience all planes of a cube simultaneously. Here's another way to picture time. If you poke your finger through the air, it passes through infinite 2D planes. A 2D creature living on one of those planes wouldn't experience your moving finger, but a 2D cross-section of a finger. In the same way, if a 4D being poked through space-time, you wouldn't see it as it is, you would see it as a 3D cross-section or a blob. The fourth dimension is easy to visualize because we are conscious of time. We're experiencing it all the, well, time. And though we can't see all time at once, higher dimensions are leaky. So there may be little hints of time or 4D space as a non-linear dimension in our daily lives. When people experience deja vu or hallucinations or see ghosts, these might be little overlapping slices telling us that multiple times, T1, T2, etc., can coexist at a common set of space coordinates, that is, X, Y, and Z. The fifth and sixth dimensions. The fifth and sixth dimensions are closely related. In these dimensions, possible realities come into play, and we start experiencing the less tangible dimensions, 5 through 10. So before we talk about the invisible dimensions, a couple good explanations. As stated earlier, we usually define a dimension as an axis, or a new degree of freedom with infinite variables. We experience space-time in 4 dimensions, so we can find coordinates in space-time with input from 4 axes, X, Y, Z, and T. The higher dimensions, 5 through 10, are hard to see. It might be easiest to represent these higher dimensions as folds, i.e., if you use a piece of paper to represent a plane, and you fold that piece of paper in two, every point on the paper has a twin that coexists at the same X and Y coordinates. You now have another axis, and though we can't see higher dimensions, they are theoretically apparent in the curvature of space-time. Here's the classic ant example. If an ant is walking a straight line down the center of a piece of paper and you roll that paper into a tube, the ant won't know he's in a three-dimensional tunnel, but if he veers right or left, he'll be in the upside down. Now on to the fifth dimension, sixth dimension, causality and alternate realities. In 4D, all time is stacked and navigable, but it only accounts for one event at each coordinate in space-time. However, we know that if time can be navigable, it can theoretically be nonlinear. Theoretically, if you went back in time and then forward again, just as in space, you may not necessarily move forward on the same line each time. You might veer right or left like the ant, and would create alternate realities that occupy the same X, Y, Z, and T coordinates. You would need a fifth axis. If you watch sci-fi movies, you know all about the fifth dimension already. You can imagine the fifth dimension as a plane where all possible timelines or branches of time stretching back to the Big Bang live simultaneously. Sometimes it's called a probability plane. One way to visualize navigating the fifth dimension is to think of it as climbing a tree. Imagine you were climbing a tree to 20 feet, and then you climb back down to the ground and back up to 20 feet, but on a different branch. Both routes get you to 20 feet, but they never intersect. And you can't jump from one to the other because they diverted way down at the trunk. Each choice creates a network of new choices in different realities or branches, causality. If you think of an event as a point, every event that led to it or is affected by it exists on its branch, and everything else is elsewhere, absolute elsewhere. Now, what if you wanted to explore all the branches without climbing back down and up and potentially ending up on the wrong branch? You would have to fold the tree so that all of the branches at the same height could be experienced at once. You would need to eliminate causality as a determiner of an event. You would have to make the branches nonlinear. You would need a new axis. You would need the sixth dimension. But here's where it gets really physics-y and theoretical. The sixth dimension is still dependent on A, our universe's point of origin, B, our universe's laws. So if we want to account for possibilities outside of these constraints, we need more dimensions. In the same way that the fifth and sixth dimension are interrelated, the seventh and eighth are bound to each other. 7, 8, 9 multiverse. In the seventh dimension, we add the following degree of freedom, different origins and laws. The first six dimensions apply to our universe with its specific origin and physical laws. But other dimensions may have different origins and be governed by entirely different laws. So if we continue with the event tracing illustration, having multiple origins would mean we would need another axis to trace any event back on the probability plane. We are now in the multiverse. Now, if we wanted to compare all of the events that coincide across all of the different universes, each with its own origin, we would have to be able to fold the seventh dimension over another plane, so that all of the origins coexist. We would need an eighth dimension. In the eighth dimension, we assume that all laws in all universes remain, well, universal. Theoretically, however, laws could evolve differently from the same point of origin, creating divergent universes that could occupy the same coordinates in eight dimensions. To account for this, we need a ninth dimension. In the ninth dimension, we can account for all events in all universes with all points of origin and all possible laws. The tenth dimension, and finally the tenth dimension. The tenth dimension, in my very humble opinion, represents the unknown. It is all of the other variables that would be necessary to assess all data in all of existence simultaneously. It is the everything fold. I hope this all made sense. It's a lot to digest. If it did make sense and you would like to learn more, there are countless great books on quantum physics for regular people, but I think the best place to start might be Flatland, A Romance of Many Dimensions. It was written in 1884 as a satirical allegory using math to illustrate different social strata. It experienced a resurgence after Einstein presented his theory of relativity, and has been name-checked by Carl Sagan and Stephen Hawking as a good way to introduce higher dimensions to anyone. Also, it's short, just over 100 pages.